Hey, everybody. Today's guest is none other than super producer extraordinaire Howard Benson, who has produced a ton of huge hit records and done a couple of Less Than Jake records, most notably Hello Rockview. We talk about History of a Boring Town and how that was the first song Howard produced that he was truly happy with. He talked about how the end of Big Crash brought him to tears because it was such a big dramatic ending, and how he applied that to future songs that he produced. We discussed a lot about the emergence of Pro Tools and how Howard was way ahead of the curve on using it. Howard also shared how he packed up all his stuff and brought it to a small studio in Florida that was more or less a demo studio to record Hello Rockview. And how he's super competitive as a producer, takes on every project, wants every other producer to die, and compares himself to Michael Jordan in his competitiveness. For all this and much more, stay tuned.
Hey, hey, have you heard? Chris DeMakes a podcast. Hey, hey, have you heard? Chris DeMakes a podcast. Hey, hey, have you heard? Chris DeMakes a podcast.
If you remember correctly, that record, the Less Than Jake Hello Rockview record, was one of the first records done in Pro Tools that was a rock band.
Yes.
And a lot of it was, I had to bring the whole system down there from, I had to pack it up from LA. And anyway, like I just really, learned how to use it. So I'm like, not only learning how to use it, I'm learning how to card it. So, I have to put it in all these kind of cases I had to buy and everything. So I got down to Gainesville, I think, where we did it. And I was really determined to use Pro Tools on that record. And I think the reason I bring that up is because that particular song was one of the first songs that I had ever produced that I was really happy with. And I think a lot of it had to do with because we had Pro Tools. And I don't think I could have produced any of that record on tape. And a lot of it was because the arrangements were still forming in my mind, and I'm sure in the band's mind. And in that song was one of the later songs that was written. And I remember really loving that song and just going, wouldn't it be great with all these harmonies and parts and stuff? And the fact that we had the computer to do a lot of the rearranging to, make the drums sound really and, time out everything, the way it is now. But, back then it wasn't done like that.
Sure.
Really, that was a big deal, and I just really liked I liked the beginning of the song. When I first heard the song, I remember thinking, wow, this is a really good song. But if you remember, there was no chorus in that song.
No, that same whole crowd that, the History of a Boring Town, the chorus part was not there. You're right. And I remember you saying, and let me just back up for a second. Everyone that I've had on, guys in bands, songwriters, it's such an integral thing what the producer does. And you're not just a producer, Howard's an arranger, a composer. And that I have to really, really stress because, you really taught us how to, the songs on Hello Rockview were pretty primitive and we went in and you were teaching us how to, there should be a bridge part here. This should do this and do that. And that's where Pro Tools came into play because you were starting to flip. I'd come into the studio the next day and you'd be like, listen to this. And the bridge wouldn't be where it was at the day before. I'd be like, whoa, that's cool.
Yeah. And that was something that really, if you were accomplished, there was a time when like, it was sort of like the Renaissance in paintings or something like that, where, when Monet was painting, where you sort of like, he was at before Monet, everybody had to go through the officials to make the record, their paintings correct. And with Pro Tools, it opened up the ability to do a lot of the things that like guys like, Bruce Fairburn and guys back then, Mutt Lange and those guys were doing because they had so much money to do records. They had like a whole year to do records and, all the cutting tape and the ways of thinking about songs because our budgets weren't as big, we had to do that in one shot. Like we had to get the drum arrangement right away. We had to get the guitars right, the vocals, all the stuff, because it was on tape and we were kind of stuck with it. Or we had to sit around and punch and punch and punch and punch and punch. And that was like, with a band like you guys, especially with the horns and everything, it makes it a harder record to make because you're dealing with like, you have to make all the decisions up front. And I wasn't thinking that way as a producer. I was thinking at that point into the future, thinking, wow, I have the ability to act like those producers, but with the computer, it levels the playing field.
Right. And what convinced you in 19? That was 1998. We did that early 98. What convinced you that this was the future? Because certainly, you know, innovations and technology, things had come in and out that you saw come and go by the wayside. What made you go that aha moment?
I think it was that, and this is from a producer's point of view, I could make the record I was hearing without having to negotiate everything with the band. Like, I could literally sit in front of the computer with my mouse. And I remember thinking, I have control. I have the mouse. And back then, no bands knew how to use Pro Tools, right?
That
took 10 years almost, or even longer from when we were using it, you know, when I started using it. And, you know, it just, I knew at that point that there was no way that producers were not going to love this technology. And it really took them 5 years to catch up to me. I think because the record before you guys was Sepultura, and I had done the Sepultura Against record in the computer, not realizing that I was actually using the computer, like they had had it, say, Apollo, because they didn't have a tape machine. So that's the only reason I got into it. And when I used it, I went, wow, this is pretty powerful stuff. But can I imagine I could apply it to like a pop rock band where you can really, you know, cause like Sepultura, bands like that, the computer's important, but they're going to put down what they're going to put down. You know, they're not going to like rearrange things. It's very much like almost progressive metal stuff, you know.
Here's what it is.
Yeah, it is what it is, right. So I kind of like thought, okay, with a band like Less Than Jake, I was willing to pack up all that stuff and bring it all the way to Gainesville. And I remember in the middle of Boring Town, and this was a big moment in my life, and you guys probably didn't realize this was happening, but I was you know, the computer was crashing all the time. Okay.
And I remember that.
Yeah. And if you looked at Pro Tools sideways, it crashed at that point. So I was using 2 gigabyte removable drives to try to get more and more space, but you had to literally delete audio all the time just so the damn thing would fit in a record. Right. So I call up DigiDesign and they used to answer the phone, you know, like,
which is amazing.
You know, I was like, hey, it's Howard. It's Steve there. You know, let me get him. So, you know, I talked to, say, Steve, you know, the IRQ, because I was using Power PCs back then, the Mac that was on the Power PC.
Right.
So the whole system was all screwy and, you know, it was thrown together. Basically, it was something that Steve Jobs came in and got rid of right away because it was so bad, the thing. But anyway, I'm talking to the guy in DigiDesign, and he goes to me, you know, we've got this kind of plugin that we got from a company up here that does stuff for the Army. And I said, what is it? They go, well, it's a company called Antares, and they make a plugin that changes that can control the pitch of vocals, like a vocal tune, an auto tune. And I said, well, just send it. And I remember a couple days later, it came to the studio in a little envelope. It was a floppy disk. It was Auto Tune 1, and there was nothing to it, just a knob, you know, and they wanted me to try it out. And I remember when we were doing Boring Town or Metalheads, I'm not sure which ones of the songs, but you were singing and you have the more tunable voice because your voice is more like straightforward. Roger's a little bit more all over the place, but it worked on both you guys. And I remember putting it on and going, oh my God, like these guys sound like they're all like, and I know with Less Than Jake, it's more of a punk ska band. So pitch wasn't like that big of a deal. It was more like the vibe, you know what I mean? But I started going, wow, I can actually, so I ended up using that plugin. And I remember when I first put it on and it was on, you know, Hello, it was on that song, you know,
Boring Town or
Rock. Yeah, Boring Town. I thought it was on Big Crash because I remember I was working on both those songs at the same time because Aaronson loved Big Crash.
Right. You know?
And I remember that and Boring Town were a pair to me, like in the same moment. And I don't know which song I put it on, but I remember thinking, wow, listen to the way those harmonies sound, you know? And then I started to produce the song more and more with that big ending.
Uh-huh.
And I wanted it to be epic. And I remember thinking, I've never been able to really make an epic song. And the way you guys could both sing together and you could harmonize and with the horns and the drum and Vinny's sort of okay with that kind of drama in a song. It was the first time I got a song that I listened to it back and I went, wow, at the end I was in tears. Every time the song comes on, I still feel that feeling, you know?
Oh, that's awesome.
It's such a big ending, you know?
Yeah.
And I applied that to like Youth of the Nation and I applied that to like Move Along. Those are the same kind of songs. Like they have big endings and they are epic sounding material. So that was why I brought up Rockview, because, and I brought up Boring Town, because, you know, I thought Big Crash was good, but we never quite accomplished the same thing. I'm not sure who it was with that one. It just...
Well, that song goes through three different key changes. I thought I was being clever. And sometimes when you're clever, it turns into crap.
Well, you know, Craig loved that song, and I gave him, tried to give him his due. The one funny thing about Hello Rockview, especially Boring Town, if you listen to the horns, they are through auto-tune too.
Oh, yeah.
And you can tell they're through auto-tune. Like, that was an overreach on my part. I always regretted that. But, you know, fast forward to mixing the record, and we went to... I think you guys had come out to Image with Chris Lord-Alge. I think.
Yeah.
You
mm-hmm.
So we wheeled the computer. Now, Chris, remember, at this point had never seen Pro Tools. You guys were the first band that he mixed in a, you know, he was a tape guy.
Yeah. And for those of you that don't know, Chris Lord-Alge has mixed everybody. If you've heard him on the radio, you've heard Chris's mixes from pop stars to rock bands. So yeah, you go wheel this stuff in there, and he was just like, what are you doing?
Yeah. He, and he goes to his tape guy. He goes, it doesn't look like tape. I don't want anything to do with it. Tell him to go away. And and I said, and you know, I was still a little like no hit producer at that point. And I was like, Chris, just give me a chance. He goes, how do I hook it up? I said, I don't know. You know, it's your studio. So he made a really good decision right then. And he decided to go analog, instead of trying to go digital, which we never would have been able to do because of all the clocking errors.
Yeah. He
decided to go out analog, in analog. And then I was sitting in the bathroom in the hallway. Remember, there was a bathroom off to the left over the right. You walk through it. And I hear him out in the hallway talking to the second engineer at a studio. And he goes, that fucking guy is so full of shit. This thing's a piece of fucking shit. That guy should take this thing out of here. Who the hell is he? And I remember sitting there going, oh my God, like this sucks. Like, this is my like second meeting with Chris Lord-Alge, and it's going south. You know, the computer's crashing. You know, nothing's worth it. It's a mess, you know. But then when we got it up working, oh, and then one thing we found out about autotune is I had it on your guys' voices, but I didn't know how to print it at that point. And every time you turned the computer on, it defaulted to C major, right?
Oh. So Chris,
you didn't see that part of it. So Chris calls me up at home and he goes, I don't know, man. Either this band writes some weird vocal parts, or there's something wrong with the way you did the vocals. Or I said, well, look at the track that's called vocal. And he goes, okay. I said, you see that little thing that goes auto-tune at the top? He goes, yeah, what's it do? I said, well, it's supposed to tune the vocals. And so what I had to do was set it for the key we were in. And at that point, it wasn't even programmable. So like, luckily you guys didn't like, you know, flip out of keys to that much. I mean, we had to do some of the mixes and pieces.
Sure.
But you know, we got it to work. So it was kind of like crazy, but it was I always say that between that record and probably the Soundgarden record that Michael Beinhorn was doing at the same time, he was in Pro Tools. I mean, the two of us were sort of in front of the world.
You're really the first. I mean, you know, everyone thinks of the auto-tune as like the Cher vocal effect, Believe in 2000. We were 3 years preceding that.
And you know what? It's still, you listen to it now, the only thing, it still sounds wackier, the horns a little bit, because they're not as punchy as they could be, again, because of the autotune.
Right.
But, you know, the vocals just sound freaking great. And Vinny, you know, I did a lot of the drum editing by visually at that point, because I didn't really know about the grid yet.
Right.
So I don't even think they had the grid on it yet. But, you know, I would just like kind of put a ruler up to the screen and measure the beats. And cut the drums to the beats. And that was crazy. I was locked in a room off to the side. I don't know if you remember that.
Absolutely. And I want to give a little backstory at this point. So, you know, Howard's a Philly guy, Philadelphia. He began playing keyboards at a young age, played in bands, and you cut your teeth in the 80s. He was producing some metal bands in the 80s, and that got it up into the early 90s. And all of a sudden, the bottom fell out of the industry. People weren't returning his phone calls, and he's like, what's going on? And, you know, you kept trudging through. It's testament to who you are, man. You kept trudging. You kept taking jobs. And you've even said it yourself that the Hello Rockview was kind of a turning point for you. You were like, okay, people are starting to return your phone calls now. You're starting to, and it wasn't long after that you started having massive hits.
Yeah, well, I think that Hello Rockview was a big shot in the arm, because I know that the it wasn't like it was selling millions of records, but the fans loved it. You could tell by, at the time, the zines that were out, and there was more and more internet stuff going on at the time that we, you know, was sort of brand new. And we were all seeing the reaction. You know, I was always worried about beating Losing Street because I had my friend Michael, who was the guy who produced
Mike that. Rosen.
Yeah, I knew Michael from, you know, working in San Francisco a little bit. And I was always competitive. I mean, he didn't know that, but I, it's funny, after watching the Michael Jordan stuff, I realized I was very much like him about being competitive with everybody. You know, I wanted to beat the shit out of every producer. Like, I didn't want anybody surviving.
And you did. You know?
Yeah, but I kind of like get, you know what I'm saying? Like I, you know, I don't know. I wanted them all to die. I was like, I hope they're all gone. You know, I want to be the only guy. And people would like take, they'd complain and go, Howard's taking every project that comes along. Yeah. And I would say to Aaliyah, my manager, take every one of them. Don't say no to anything. Because well, you know what? Who knows, right? Does anybody really know?
No. Any of this stuff? And especially Lynn, because things were changing so fast with the technology, you know, and it's just, it's amazing that you really had that gut and you were working with Pro Tools. It was so primitive. You're putting a damn ruler up to the screen to measure drum hits. I mean, you know, and then you're walking into Chris Lord-Alge, who at the time he had a pretty darn good name for himself, and you're trying to make connections and you're going, uh-oh, is this door getting slammed in my face? Am I making the right decision by doing this? You know, I can tell you one thing, that Hello Rockview is to this day, probably the number one fan favorite record. There was a number of things that came together with that record. Roger and I were, we had been a band for about 5 years. We were starting to learn really how to sing well together, but I can't stress enough of the arrangement, the composing part. I mean, I learned how to sing on that record, not so much from being under the whip of you and on the mic live. That definitely helped. It was after the record, hearing how you put the vocals together and how they were in tune. Now it's like, oh shit, I got to replicate that live.
That's a really interesting thing you just said. Like, I've never had a singer say that to me about.
Oh yeah. That, and I mean that with all my heart. I learned how to sing on that record. I mean, my voice, I was a ragtag punk singer, and we certainly had underlying pop sensibilities and wanted to have great harmonies, but Losing Streak was just, it was to cut the tape. It wasn't nothing was lined up. And there's a certain charm to that record, but it was Hello Rockview where it all came together. And then it was like, okay, now we have to play these songs. Now I have to learn how to, and Roger and I practiced our ass off.
I remember that I was shocked about one thing in that you guys, I didn't know you guys at all. And when I remember, I came down to meet you guys and I assumed, I didn't know who wrote the lyrics, right? And because I love that New Jersey sentiment that is in a lot of those lyrics, the visual street thing. And when I found out Vinny wrote a lot of that, you know, like that was sort of his conceptual thing. It really kind of like, it was shocking a little bit that he was coming up with that stuff. Like, I just didn't think that would come out of him, you know?
And I had so many people, that's a great thing you brought up. I had so many people over the years say, well, how are you singing songs that you didn't write? How can you sing them from the heart? And you got to remember, I met Vinny when I was 15 years old, and him and I started writing songs together. We were in high school, and that's all I knew. He'd hand me these lyrics and go, make something out of that. So they came from the heart. I had nowhere else.
Yeah, it takes a lot, though. Let me tell you something. People undervalue. Well, actually, they don't, but you look at Sinatra and people like that. But if you can deliver what somebody else wrote, you're almost lyrically, that to me is mad respect, because I think a lot of singers don't have that breadth of experience in their lives. They can only do what's internally there, and that's it. They don't really do well singing other people's stuff. Mm-hmm. And I think the fact that you were always, you and both you guys, you and Roger, were a great mouthpiece for like the sentiment that, you know, I always believed it. Let's put it that way, you know?
And I think that's testament to why we're still around, is that believability. It wasn't just some we had a silly songs here and there, but we weren't the wacky party ska band. We were like, we had this crazy live party vibe, but there was this underlying relatable, serious tone with the lyrics. I mean, a song like Al's War, that's a sad lyric. And sometimes I think I'm the only one who feels like going nowhere, like giving up. Sometimes I think I'm the only one.
I love that song.
Yeah.
That was probably my favorite lyric on the whole record. I just, was it sad? Because I always thought he was like the lyric where he goes, he's under the streetlight and he's proclaiming his, freedom.
Right.
And there must have been, I mean, I thought that was very like uplifting.
Yeah, it was uplifting. I say sad. It was there.
There'll be days like this.
Yeah. More serious tone than sad. It was a serious subject, but it was sung with this energy that came across. And like I said, to this day, especially in England, that record just that made us, for lack of a better word, superstars over there. I mean, you go up to today, people still have all the time Hello Rockview tattoos at the front cover. And, kiss your butt or anything like that, but I have had kids, especially in England, talk about you, and we've worked with some big name, we've worked with Rob Cavallo, and Rob's amazing in his own right, but I've never had kids come up and talk about the producer, Howard Benson, that record, it sounds amazing, it's this and it's that. And again, there was something really, really special about what we created.
Well, I'll tell you one thing, it couldn't have been in a worse like place, because we were in a studio that was like old, kind of run down in Gainesville, which was empty of people at that point.
And yeah, we recorded in the summer when the school enrollment goes from 50,000 to about 10,000 people. So it was a ghost town. And we had Howard put up in this section of town. It was one of those suites. It has like a little kitchenette in it.
Yeah.
And we shoved you down there in a rental car. And you and I talked about this not too long ago, which is crazy. There was no internet, no way to pass your time. You weren't a drinker. You weren't going to be going out to the bars after the sessions. You were a family man at that point. And I said, what the hell were you doing when you go back?
Because I could say exactly what I was doing.
You said you were playing video games.
I was playing Nintendo. I dragged my Nintendo NES down. And I played I think I was on Mario Brothers 2 at that point. Like I was the girl, I was playing the four characters in that one, and they're in the sand and all that. I just got stuck on that. And Mega Man and,
Oh, because nowadays you would take your session home if you wanted to and work on it.
Okay. Well, of course. Yeah, that's what we would have made the record, probably not faster, but it would have been a different vibe. But yeah. I used to go to the studio though on the weekends and do a lot of editing.
Yeah. And I remember, we respected you for a number of reasons, but you were an LA producer. It was like this big LA producers come. We never worked with anybody like you. And I remember you were in that little room, and this, Mirror Image in Gainesville, guys, is a really small studio. It's a demo studio, basically, that we were recording Hello Rockview in. And we get this guy from LA to come in, and he's in this little room editing on this new system, Pro Tools. There's Howard in there. And I remember you threw down your headphones. You're like, can I get a fucking second in here? And we're like, a second? You need more time? You're like, no, a second. We were so green, we didn't know what that meant. That he was asking for a second engineer. There wasn't even a second engineer in Gainesville, let alone at Mirror Image.
I remember that. I used to be a lot more feisty back then.
But
who was the engineer? What was the guy's name that did the recording?
Bob McPeak was there, and then we had Steve Kravac. Was
Steve Kravac?
Yeah,
Steve from LA, right? Did he come from LA?
Steve's an LA guy. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
because I think I think we picked them together somehow. Like I forget, he did some other records that were stuff you guys liked.
He produced an MXPX record that we
liked.
That's
what it was.
And he had also done some stuff in the 80s for a Canadian band. Steve's Canadian, so he did this band that no one knows that I used to love. And so, yeah, there was, that was some of it. But, I mean, here you were at the time. I mean, you were fighting to get your name back because you had a decent name in the 80s. And then when the bottom fell out, like I said, it was hard to get phone calls. You had told me at some point you were kind of having doubts about a career in music still. And here you are clawing your way back to the top. And it's like, when you were screaming about the second that day, I saw your frustration. I remember it. But you weren't about to give up and quit. You couldn't. You were in the trenches at that point.
Oh yeah. At that point I'd already I think that I'd switched management. I had a decent manager and, I'd just done Zebrahead 2. I'm not sure if that record, I think, I'd done only the one yellow one at that point, but you guys had liked that band.
I remember the yellow cover on Dr. Dream, the the major label record wasn't out yet, Waste of Mind.
Yeah. Yeah. The yellow one. And, you know, I own Dr. Dream. That's kind of why we put it on Dr. Dream. That was a whole nother part of my life at that point. But like, you know, that was also another band that wasn't quite in Pro Tools yet, but was, and you guys liked them because they were sort of crazy and rappy and ska-ish and like they were all over the place.
Yeah.
You know, but they were kind of similar to you where they had a singer with a big voice who carried the choruses.
Sure.
You know? And that's what you did, you know, and you had, you could carry those choruses. And, you know, I just remember thinking, you know, if we could get some really good songs, you guys had everything else going for you. You know, you had the touring, you had the, you know,
the merchandise.
You had a major label, you know, Craig really believed in you and it was all really good. You know,
We've mentioned a couple of times, the name Craig, Craig Aronson was our A&R person at Capitol who ended up signing us again to Warner Brothers. So right. He definitely was a believer, in the band. So let's go a little left of center here now and talk about, you know, when did you know, at what age? Because I know you, again, you played keyboards, you were in a number of bands. I've seen the pictures, I've seen the afro. and when did you know that this is my calling? I think I can produce records, I can do this. Was it when you were producing your own bands back then?
Yeah, I think it was also the lack of success of our band. Like I was in a, you know, the one thing we came out to, you know, I was working in as an engineer actually for an aerospace company. So when I went back in Philly, I went to Drexel University and got my degree in materials engineering, which is basically that mechanical and electrical. It's basically aerospace. So when I came to California, I'd worked for Garrett Air Research from when I was like 21 to 25. And, you know, I worked in leading edge slat actuation systems. I was like a full on nerd. I had the pocket protector, the whole bit, you know, and it was a good job. It was in Torrance. I mean, I made good money. It was at the time, like 25,000 a year. It was 1981 or something. So I did that for 4 years, but at the same time, my band, you know, some of them came out from Philly, the guitar player who was my main guy, kind of like your Roger-ish or whatever, Vinny, you know, and we've got some band guys together and we started making, you know, demos. And I was very lucky to run into a guy from Sunset Sound named Bill Jackson. I was introduced to him and he got me into Sunset Sound, to use the studio. As long as he engineered was his angle, I could produce stuff. And I skipped a pretty crucial step in my like development as a producer. I started producing without having like any mentors. So I came straight in as a producer. I didn't do engineering. I'm talking about audio engineering, no second engineering, no coffee, nothing. I just found the artist, got the music together and started doing that. And a lot of it was because my band sucked. I mean, we would play shows and people, you know, across the street would be Motley Crue and we'd be laughing at them because they sucked, you know,
right.
But really we sucked. And it was, you know, you realize at some point in your life that, you know, you're a pretty well-adjusted guy, maybe in comparison to most people in Hollywood. And it takes a certain like, you know, I don't know what you would call it. I just was too well. I was brought up really well. So as I kind of came to the conclusion, I really have no problems really to talk about with anyone. And I don't have any like, I don't have anything to say to the youth of America at all. So that kind of takes me out of being in a band, right? So I kind of like decided, okay, you know what? I'm doing these demos with my band and people seem to like the demos and they want to hire me to do demos for other people. So about 4 years into my engineering thing down in Torrance, I said, you know what? I'm going to take a couple years off from engineering, which my parents almost went bananas because they spent all this money sending me to college and try doing producing. And you know what happens in Hollywood? Success is always around the corner.
Sure.
So you never quite know how far the corner really is from you. So, you know, I stopped, you know, doing the engineering and started producing demos and demos and demos. And I finally did a band called TSOL by accident. I actually met them in Hollywood and Vine at a Denny's. And, you know, it just one thing leads to another. And, you know, I think when I met you guys, there was like, I had gone through, I think, two or three ups and downs at that point where like I was not successful. Then I got a little bit of success and I was not successful. Then a little bit. So I kind of knew how to handle the valleys, you know,
right.
Like I was, you know, in fact, when I met you guys, I had just been fired from Giant Records. I was working as an A&R guy there.
I remember.
Yeah. And I mean, we like, our label was bought by, you know, we were folding up and they were going to, you know, the Eagles came back and the guy who worked there, Irving Azoff, ran a company, manages the Eagles. So all of a sudden we decided the company wasn't really worth anything doing anymore. So I was let go and I went through a lot of stuff like that. So it was a lot of, like, honestly, very typically in Hollywood, you're basically failing the whole time, you know, and you may have a little success, but nothing's happening and you're failing and failing and failing. And then finally, I think like anything else, you learn, you know, by, you know, the streetwise, what to do and what not to do, but you really don't know it at the time. You know, like you just feel like shit all the time because you haven't any hit records and you keep producing records and nothing's a hit. But so when you guys came along, it was like after I'd done a few Motorhead records. So I started doing bigger band. All of a sudden I kind of got my mojo back with Motorhead and Zebrahead. And then you guys came along and really shortly after you guys, I kind of got POD, which was something that, you know, I think by doing Rockview and by doing all those records and pre-POD and having the engineering background, the aerospace background, the computer was not that difficult for me to pick up. Uh-huh. You know, I had already done CAD-CAM stuff and designed wings for airplanes. I mean, geez, recording digital music, nobody dies, you know?
Yeah, well, that's funny you bring that up. I was just talking about this something the other day. When I first put my Pro Tools studio together back in 2003, I had never worked on a Mac before. So I had to learn how to work on the whole system. That's what took me the longest. I already kind of knew my way around recording a little bit, but that's what took me the longest was learning the computer.
And a lot of people don't know what's really going on digitally. Like, mm-hmm. like, because on analog, you know, I'm talking about people of my level, they visualize the sound hitting tape and the magnetic dipoles and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, biasing the tape and all this kind of shit. So they think that way. But in computers, we're talking about ones and zeros and sampling rate and bit rate and, you know, all this kind of stuff that makes no sense to anybody back then. Mm-hmm. You know, like I used to have artists say to me, I can't believe I can record into a computer and I can hear it back. I mean, at that time it was magic, like, because you had to use tape.
Yeah. Like, it's almost tape. It would be unfathomable if you came from a complete, I mean, I came from an analog background, but it was kind of like, I don't know. It also happened so fast and I was younger, but you take someone that's my age now, back then someone's 45 years old and going, yeah, you can record a computer. They would tell you you're crazy.
And they did. And that's kind of what kind of benefited me was a lot of reticence to get into it. I remember even up to 2003, I was getting projects where people would go, listen, we're only hiring you because you know how to use Pro Tools. Like the other three guys we talked to said, we have to use tape because of the sound and the saturation and the drum sound and all this other kind of stuff. And the more you use it, the more you realize, you know what really isn't that important is all that crap that they talk about. What's really mm-hmm. important is the songs and the vocal performances and the big picture shit. Like whether the drums sound a little bit better on tape than they do in a computer or less, blah, blah, blah. That never affects anything. Nobody, no. I mean, look at what happened with the MP3, you know, that didn't affect anything. And that made records for a while. Music sounded like shit.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know? You brought up a good point. So I want to go back for a second. Now you're growing up. Did you know, like when you'd hear stuff on the radio as a 14, 15, 18 year old kid, were you analyzing why songs were hits at that point? Did you consciously do that?
Yeah, in my own way, I was actually in so many bands when I was a kid. Like when I went to Drexel, my grade point average was pretty shitty because I was in like three bands. I was like in a fraternity band. I was in a disco band that played down the shore in Wildwood and Cape May and all that. And then I was in a local band that wrote songs. So instead of going to class and learning about what I should have been learning about, I was always involved in making and arranging other people's songs, not mine. I wasn't writing songs yet. But I was always fascinated by the sound of things. Like I remember when I first heard Light My Fire, that was really the song that changed my life because I remember the sound of the organ, the sound of the Vox Continental.
Uh-huh.
And I remember thinking, what the hell is that?
Right.
Like I remember the sound of it was so, and then I realized that part of the reason I liked music too was my mom was a piano teacher. My mom would always be downstairs playing the piano. And she used to play a lot of like T for Two and songs that had 2-5 progressions, you know, and like, you know, D minor G or F sharp, F minor, B flats, you know, those kind of progressions. and Light My Fire comes out, and it's essentially a 2-5 progression, right? And not knowing at the time what that was, I just know I liked it, you know? Uh-huh. So I kind of looked up the Doors, and I bought an organ, and I'd gotten a band, and, you know, just for fun. But then you realize, and you know how this is, I'm sure, once you get in a band, that's it for you, you know? I mean, you know, especially if you like, you know, the attention you get from girls and, you know, all that. Back then, in the, you know, right, really in the 70s and 80s, there weren't as many bands, so it was a lot easier to stick out in the crowd. You know?
Sure, sure.
So, you know, but, you know, I guess I always, it's weird because my life was always music and engineering. I liked the technical aspect of it a lot, but I also loved the music. And I think I never, I was very lucky to kind of have both. You know, I didn't really
right.
have to, I didn't have to learn in a studio for 8 years about how a patch bay worked or how a tape machine worked or how the, I don't even really care about the rest of it. I mean, honestly, I still have engineers do all that stuff for me. If somebody said to me, hey, can you show me how to mic a guitar amp? I'd be like, no.
Yeah, but that wasn't what you were concerned with. You were concerned with the hit. Let somebody mic the amp. I'm going to sit here and work on the arrangement. And that's why you continue to do what you do, which leads me to my next thing. So, you know, you get done with Less Than Jake, and now you're getting into the PODs, the My Chemical Romance, the Hoobastanks. Now you're having hit record after hit record. Now, I know many great producers over the years that just kind of hit stumbling blocks, didn't have hit records after a while. They maybe weren't getting the songs that they, or the projects they are, you know, good enough songs to produce. That had to have happened to you through that, like the Hoobastanks. I know you could be picky and choosy at that point. You were having hits, but like certainly some bands were still coming to you with stuff that you're like, oh, this needs some work. And you really had to put some work behind it. And what kind of struggle was that sometimes? Because certainly you might have a band that you work with that sold 2 million records. Now you're doing the next record and you're like, guys, the songs just aren't there yet.
Well, I think that really never made a difference to me back then. I mean, I honestly didn't think of any of them. I actually thought doing band's sophomore records was harder than doing their first record. You know, a lot of times there was a massive amount of expectation for the next one if they
sure,
had a hit.
Sure.
And I realized that early on when I had a hit with Hoobastank's second album and Cold as well, their second album. And I remember thinking, you know what? I'm going to pitch myself as someone that can do the sophomore record. I'm not scared to take that last shot. I'm not scared to be the Kobe. Like, give me the ball. I'll do
right.
it. You know, because a lot of people fucked up the second album. So Papa Roach was a great example of doing a first album. A second album was a stiff. And then they hired me, you know. But I looked at it like, I'm going to approach every album as if it's the band's first album. Like, every one of them. If it's the fifth album, I'm approaching it like the first album. Like, you got to prove to me you have great songs. And we have to go in and record this like it. You could get dropped after this album.
Well,
and essentially, that's the truth.
Yeah, and I'm not so sure. And again, this isn't you know, kissing up to you. I mean this with all my heart. I'm not so sure that Papa Roach, if they wouldn't have went with you, if that third record would have been a success. I know that you were integral in putting that thing together. I know you were, and your track record proves that. It was record after record, and all those bands you were working with, no offense to them, they couldn't have just been coming to you, handing you gold every time. Here's a gold song, make it sound good. Here's a gold song. I mean, it's testament to what you were bringing to these bands, and that's why you were getting people to come, and why your career hasn't taken a dip since then. I mean, it's been remarkable.
The Rejects were a really good one because they came to me and I said no, and they said, well, fuck you, Howard. We'll get somebody else. And 6 months went by, and I said no because the songs weren't good. That's all. It wasn't because I didn't like them or
right.
anything like that. But I went to Atlanta, saw them play, and said no. And then 6 months later, they called back and they said, you know what? Maybe you're right. Maybe we do need better songs. And then they wrote Dirty Little Secret and Move Along. And Move Along was a song I helped out with a lot. That was a song that, you know, I mean, both those songs I did a lot of work on, but Move Along especially was lyrically nothing like it ended up being. And that was just, and at the time, you know, I felt really in touch with that kind of thing. I had, I had some people in my life who were going through really bad times with work. Like they didn't know what to do with their lives and they were frozen in place. And I remember when Tyson wrote that lyric, it wasn't quite about that, but I remember we had a late night discussion and we just said, you know, let's just personalize that lyric. And those are the kind of things that you like, you have to run with those feelings. You know what I mean? Like you don't know when they're going to hit or you don't know who you're going to be surrounded with that maybe echoing what somebody might say, you know, it's very chaotic. That's the one thing. It's so chaotic, you know, but one, I mean, I think that also, I also had a really good team and I still do. And I focus on the important stuff. I don't, I try not to get out of focus when it comes to like, you know, they asked Steven Spielberg a really good question on his special. They said, have you ever thought about what really makes your music, your films great? What the special sauce is? And he goes, you know, I really hate that question because if I think about it, I may not have it anymore. Like in other words, he doesn't know what it is. And the more he thinks about it, the scarier it becomes, you know? And I sort of have that same feeling about things. Like I sort of don't really know what it is, but I think that it's sort of something, it's kind of like when you guys go up and play a show, you guys can go up and play a show and you know when you've killed it, but sometimes you don't know what day that's going to be. Like, you don't know, like,
and some days you went up there and you thought you killed it, but you didn't.
That's right.
And you don't know why. So we're getting near the end here. We're going to wrap up. I just, I got a question I want to ask you. And so aside from your family and your children, which tell them I said hello, you know, outside of personal stuff, I'm just speaking about career. What is your proudest moment? I'm looking here at my notes. I mean, you had the best pop vocal album for Kelly Clarkson. You won a Grammy for that. You know, won a best hard rock performance for Love Bites from Hailstorm. You producer of the year. I mean, you've had all these accolades, but what's your proudest moment?
You know, it's funny. I think that maybe just because how I've had some, you know, I struggled in my career early on. I think the proudest moments are when I've been able to get off the ground. I think that's when you're off the mat and you just, there was a time, I think after Bang Tango's second album came out and it didn't even come out. They dropped the band. And then I did a band called Little Caesar that barely came out. Like this is the end of the hair band era.
Sure.
And a lot of my records were being not released. And because the labels had already moved on to Nirvana and modern rock and all that. And I remember thinking to myself, you know, I don't have any money in the bank. I've got like, you know, one kid. I don't know what to do here. And all I knew is I was going to book a flight to South by Southwest and try to find a band to sign that was a modern rock band. And I went down there and a friend of mine sent me to Austin Rehearsal Complex and I found a band. And somehow by hook or crook, I got this band signed to Atlantic, then to Giant Records because the Atlantic deal, they weren't going to have me produce it. So I got Irving Azoff somehow to pay it. Like it literally was like one wrong move and my career would have been over, you know? And I ended up being an A&R guy for Giant. And it was the fact that I didn't give up at that moment. I think that's, you know, I think that anybody will tell you, you know, those are the kind of things that it's the struggle that you kind of are proud of. It's not, you know,
I kind of thought you were going to say, that's why I brought up the Grammys and most people that are in your position that have that type of crazy success and accolades and the gold record on, you know, platinum record on the wall, they're going to say what you said because that's really what you remember. That's the shit that got you to the Grammy.
Yeah. The rest of it is, look, I'm very happy to get all that stuff. And I like, it's very important for business to have all those gold records and platinum records.
Sure.
The artists won't agree, you know, believe anything you say unless you have them. So, you know, I think that, you know, and that's also something when I did you guys, I didn't have any platinum records or gold records when I did your band. And the fact that we came out with something so good without me really being, I mean, personally, I wasn't that believing in myself at that point. Like I sort of wished I had a platinum record to walk in the studio with, and I still didn't, you know? And so I always doubted whether you guys were paying attention or you really believed, you know, there's always that doubt in your mind, you know,
like, yeah.
Well, and if I were that good, I'd have a platinum record, you know?
And of course we didn't know any better. We were so green. I was 23 when I made that record. I had no idea.
Yeah. Yeah. But we had a fun time doing that list of hair bands. So I still have that list.
I know you do. we were recording Hello Rockview, Howard and I came up with a list of every 80s. God, we would laugh. I'd be like, Cats in Boots. You're like, how the hell do you know those guys?
Yeah, I actually lived it, and I was in the scene in that time, and you knew more than me. Like, I didn't know half those bands.
So, lastly, we're going to leave our listeners here with what's going on with you. Time to plug everything, Howard Benson.
You mean like the records I'm on?
Oh no, just any projects you're going on. And I know you have the plugins that you've recently released. If you'd like to talk about that.
Well, yeah, the Howard Benson vocal plugin,
which is amazing.
And you can sing like Chris DeMakes.
Yeah, I use it for every session that I do at home on my demos. I love it. It's Howard Benson vocals. It's amazing.
Well, it's funny. The guys in 3 Days Grace use it on every instrument. Like I just use it on vocals, but I can see how you can use it on like everything, because it's got all kinds of crazy stuff, but it's also presets are pretty easy to use.
Oh, Plotnikov's got one in there, just has acoustic guitar, and I put it on my acoustic and it shimmers and shines. It sounds amazing. I love the plugin. And then there is also STL tones, and that's the guitar suite, which is awesome. The rock lead that you have on there, I use it for everything. It's so cool.
Oh yeah. I use I'll tell the listeners what I use. I use amp number 3. And I use the center cabinet. And I don't know why I like that, but I blend that into every one of my real guitar tones. And it just seems like it adds beef to like a real recording. Because a lot of times I love real guitar tones and all that. But the one thing about plugins is it makes everything super present. And it's sort of like fun to have that mixed in to, you know, because, you know, we have the budgets where we can do like the real deal, things. So, and I just finished, what did I just finish? I did the 10 years record that just came out.
Okay.
And I think In Flames will come out later this year. I finished that. I'm doing Apocalyptica this week with Jacoby singing a vocal on Apocalyptica's record. And then I had the Issues record last year that did really well. And a new 3 Days Grace record coming up. And, awesome. You know, just, I mean, somebody has to make the records. It might as well be me, right?
It might as well be you. And I am so happy for you, man. I'm honored to call you a friend, and I'm really happy that you were able to be on the show, man. Thank you very much.
The Wrap with Chris and Chris.
Well, once again, like a broken record, here I am again to say that was a really great episode, Chris. But I will say that this episode was supposed to be about History of a Boring Town, but I kind of went out on a big tangent of other things involved in the recording of Hello Rockview and just Howard in general. And I wanted to hear a little more about History of a Boring Town.
So what went wrong, strung you along? We didn't talk much about this song. So what went wrong, strung you along? We didn't talk much about this song.
So yeah, you know, when I had contacted Howard, he's got a multitude of songs that he could have picked from his career. I mean, he's done everybody from, you know, My Chemical Romance to Daughtry to Kelly Clarkson, you know, multi-platinum huge hit records. I was stoked he wanted to talk about History of a Boring Town. And then just like any other time Howard and I get to talking, we tend to go off on a tangent. He likes to talk. I like to talk. Lo and behold, we talked about a ton of stuff. But Boring Town, you know, I remember I was still living in Park 16th Apartments in Gainesville, Florida, which has been referenced in a few Less Than Jake songs. Some of the fans will know. I was living in apartment 107, which was a song on Losing Streak. Remember, the song went through a lot of different changes. There was no chorus. You know, that same old crowd, that part wasn't written, I believe, until we got in the studio. And Roger and I were living together with Vinny in 107, and Roger had decided to get his own place, apartment 22, in the same complex, and he moved. And around that time, we had convinced Capitol Records to buy us a 16-track digital recorder. And, you know, Roger was starting to learn his way around that thing. And, you know, Hello Rockview was the first record that we actually did our own demos for. And Boring Town was one of those songs.
Yeah, man, you just brought it up, and I brought this up to you about this song. You kind of brought it up in a way, but I wanted to ask you, what is the chorus of this song? Because I never thought about it before, but there's the boring life in a boring town part, which I think of as the chorus. But then there's the that same old town. That part also seems like the chorus. So this is the $1 million question, man. What is the chorus of this song?
Well, that's what I'm considering the chorus now is you know, that same old crowd. You know, that to me is the chorus. And that's what Howard was looking for. Because the beginning up into that part, it's the same three chords. It's G or A G to D the whole time. It's just kind of looped. And, you know, when it gets to that lyric that you were just speaking of, you know, and of course all the whoa-oh-ohs are there. And it kind of, I kind of thought, I guess, that was a chorus. And Howard's like, no, it's got to go somewhere else. And, you know, right. There was other things. The horn part at the end, bum ba da da dum ba da dum, that was a guitar lick that I had written. So after like, I don't know, maybe the second verse, it went to the bridge part or before the bridge part, which the bridge is still in the song. It had stopped, and then the guitar just went ding 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 like this thing, and you know, Howard was like, well, "What is that? It kind of comes out of nowhere, and it doesn't really do anything." And we ended up making that the horn line, which we still do a lot to this day, as we'll, you know, something will be written on a guitar that translates better on horns, and or sometimes the horns do something that translates better on guitar. So it just kind of depends on what works for that particular song.
Right. Hey, and it's a real testament to you guys as songwriters and to how you guys worked with Howard and what he brought to the table that I honestly think that even without the big breakdown, which you're calling the chorus, the boring life in a boring town part could have been the chorus. And for 99% of bands, if they would have had that song and had that, what I'm calling what I thought was the chorus at first, the boring life in a boring town part, that would have been it. They would have just been like, well, that's our chorus. That's the song. Build it around that. And yeah, maybe there wouldn't have been a lot of changes, but we've talked about that on this podcast too, about songs where things change within the same chord progression. There's builds and melodies change, but the chord progression stays the same. So, you know, that's cool that Howard pushed you guys to take the song there, because it just became this way more epic of a song.
Well, you know, it also drops to halftime there. So the drums, and then that's when the big guitars come in at that chorus. So it just kind of lifts that whole part, and it just kind of needed it. The interesting thing about this song, you know, it goes to a second verse, which is a little bit shorter than the first, picks back up with the second chorus. And then from there, it goes to the bridge. And after the bridge, it goes to a guitar lead that has a interplay with some horns. And then it comes back into essentially a verse. But the verse now is heavy. It's got heavy guitars. It's not ska. And then it has an outro. A boring life, a boring town, whoa-ohs are happening. So it's kind of still harking back to the verse, but it never goes back to what we're calling the chorus now.
Right.
And that was our quirkiness in the early days of you know, and sometimes we try to get back to that because there's a certain charm of that. But I remember, because of course this was done on Pro Tools, that Howard had sent, I still have the cassette somewhere, I'd love to dig that out and digitize it, but he had actually stuck the chorus at the end of the song again. So after it comes back to the, what would be like, I guess the third verse, essentially, he had made an edit, and it comes back to the chorus, and the chorus loops, and it kind of just fades out. That same old crowd. And it just goes, it never says a boring life, a boring, whoa, like the verse, how it ends now, that wasn't there. He had chopped it, and he said, you know, what do you guys think of this? And we were just so, for lack of a better word, punk rock, like, no, it can't go back to the chorus. And I don't know. Hindsight's 2020. I don't think I could change the song now, but it probably should have went back to that, because that chorus is so catchy.
Yeah, I mean, it's great. The other thing I wanted to touch on before we finish up here is just the theme of the song, which it's another thing we've touched upon. You and I have talked about that. Everyone can relate to, or most people anyway, about, you know, your town being this boring place that you want to leave, And I don't care if you're living in Tennessee or you're living in Pennsylvania or if you're living in Malibu, at some point someone feels that that feeling like, oh, I got to get out of this place. This place is boring. Everywhere else is cooler than this. And, you know, I feel like this is the quintessential Less Than Jake song that conveys that feeling. And it's probably why it's one of the most popular Less Than Jake songs.
Yeah. I mean, you know, that was a lot of our themes in our early tunes, this and Look What Happened, about leaving town, about, you know, getting out and starting over, starting fresh. And I think everybody can kind of relate to that. You know, there was, people that we knew, Vinny's friends from New Jersey, that swore it was about up there. And then there was our friends from Port Charlotte, Florida, that swore the song was written about Port Charlotte. And it could be written about anywhere in the world.
Was it written about somewhere in particular?
No, that's the thing. It really wasn't. But certainly it was modeled after definitely where Vinny and I met. You know, Port Charlotte, Florida was a very sleepy little retirement community, for lack of a better word. And there wasn't much to do. It was boring as hell. And, you know, that's why we gravitated towards punk rock. It gave us an outlet in a town that, you know, would shut down at 9 o'clock every night.
True. That's it. Yeah. Yeah. definitely relatable to probably most people listening to this, because most people aren't living in Vegas or something like that. So, yeah, anyway, man, yeah, that's really interesting. Obviously, the songwriting aspect. I'm glad I get to talk to you. I get to interview you for a second here about songwriting. I get to play the Chris DeMakes. And, speaking of songwriting, I hope you like my segue there. If anyone out there is interested in having a custom song written for them by Chris, you can actually do that. You can hit up Chris. Chris, do you want to tell them about that for a minute?
I would love to. Yeah. Thank you, everybody out there, for the support. I'd love to write you a custom song jingle for your business, for your pleasure. Also offering, Chris and I are offering custom animation with a custom song. And you can find out all about this at ChrisDeMakes.com, which redirects you to the YouTube page. You can see our examples. I want to thank each and every one of you. You know, we started talking about this last week, about the animation and the custom song, and already got a couple orders coming in. We could do animation for your band, for your business, for your family, whatever you can think of, we'd love to. I'd love to write you a custom song. I also offer one-on-one live video sessions. And for more information on all that, you can write me at chrisdemakes@gmail.com. I can be found on Instagram at @LessThanChrisD, on Twitter at @LessThanChris, and on Facebook at the official Chris DeMakes. And yeah, please subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts. And if you could join the Chris DeMakes a Podcast Facebook group, we'd really appreciate it. And the best thing for us is word of mouth. Please tell a friend about us. We'd really appreciate it.
Yeah, we got some really great episodes coming up. So, you know, stay tuned.
Until next week. See you then.